right? You add all those earnings and divide by 5. Sure? So if you do that, how will you write this? You write 1 plus 1 minus 1 plus 1. Sure? Now let me take all the plus 1 on one side and minus 1 on one side. So this will be 1 plus 1 plus 1 minus 1 minus 1 upon 5. Right? This is nothing but 3 to 1 upon 5. Sure, folks? This is nothing but 'X' bar, the average of x. Right? Now you see what is x bar? What is plus 1 and minus 1? The variable, the two outcomes of the random variable. So plus 1 and minus 1 are two outcomes of the random variable. What is 3 upon 5? The proportion of heads. You call it the relative frequency of 1. The number of times one occurs divided by the total number of occurrences, so relative frequency of one. What is 2 upon 5 then? Relative frequency of minus 1. So what is x bar? X bar is each value of the random variable multiplied by the associated relative frequency and sum. You see that x bar is nothing but 1 into 3 by 5 plus minus 1 into 2 by 5. 3 by 5 is the number of, relative number of times which you get 1. 2 by 5 is the relative number of times you get minus 1. So sample mean is nothing but each value of the random variable multiplied by its relative frequencies. Each value of the random variable multiplied by its relative frequencies. Right? Sure? Oh. Now, suppose I play this game not 5 times. But say 5,000 coins. So I am tossing not one coin, not 5 times, but tossing the coin 50,000 times. So how many possible outcomes are there now? 2 raised to 50,000. Huge number, right? Okay. And then I get many such outcomes, right? Now if I toss this coin 50,000 times, instead of tossing it just 5 times, do you still expect the relative proportion of heads to be 1? 3 by 5? 3 by 5 and the relative proportion of tails to be 2 by 5? Would you expect that? If you toss this coin 50,000 times instead of just 5, you would still expect 60% times to get a head and 40% times to get a tail? You would expect that? Then what would you expect? Yeah? What would you expect? 50-50%? You would say that you would expect the heads and the tails to be more evenly balanced, which means that as the number of heads keeps on increasing, the relative proportions, relative frequencies will get closer and closer to 0.5 and 0.5, which are the probabilities of a head and the probabilities of a tail. 0.5 is the probability of a head, 0.5 is the probability of a tail, right? Okay, so what happens is, as the sample size, so basically x bar, okay, is what? Relative frequency of x1 into x1 plus relative frequency of x2 into x, right? Now, as the sample size becomes bigger and bigger and bigger, which means that you're tossing a coin more and more times, you'd expect this to get closer and closer to the probability of x1, you will get this to get closer and closer to the probability of x2. Right? So they would expect this number to get closer and closer to 0.5 into 1 plus 0.5 into minus 1, which is 0. Right? So you would expect the sequence. As the number of observations goes up, you would expect 1, sequence is like 1, then you have a sequence of random variables, x bars, based on increasingly larger sample sizes to get closer and closer to 0. So 0 will be a kind of a limit of a sequence. We talked about limits yesterday and sequences, right? So if you, for example, think of x bar 5 as this, which is 1, right? What is x bar 5? It's a sample mean based on a sample of size 5. Then you can similarly think of x bar 10. You can think of x bar 15. You can think of x bar 20, right? What would be x bar 20? Sample mean based on 20 tops. And you would expect as, so what you really say is x bar n will be a sample based on the size n. You would say limit and n tends to infinity, it will go to some limit, no? Where the relative frequency will get closer and closer to probability. This limit you call the expectation of x. This limit we call the expectation of x. So this 0, for example, is the expectation of this sequence. Is the right? Sure? So can somebody define the expectation of a random variable now? For me, do the following experiment. I always do this experiment which helps me a lot. Once you learn a new concept, and it's an important concept, right, you have to ensure that you really have internalized that concept. Then close your eyes and think of explaining that concept to your grandmother who is very intelligent but has never gone to school. Right? So try and tell me how you will explain this concept to your grandmother in about 3 or 4 sentences, right? If you can do that in your mind, then you are sure that you have understood that idea. So once you try that experiment and immediately you get stuck at the second sentence, then it means that you need to go back and revise those ideas, right? So how will you explain that to your grandmother? Who can try? What do you mean by the expectation of a random variable? They call it the mathematical expectation. What do you mean by the expectation of a random variable?
It's a mean value.
Grandmother gives a mean value. Forget you're learning is statistics. The color statistics is most completely useless.
The value that x bar is expected to take as n tends to.
The value x bar is expected to, the value that x bar will get closer and closer and closer. Remember my cake yesterday never vanished, no? But 0 was the limit. I could make it as small as possible. So x bar might never take that expected value. It is the limit to which x bar will go as the sample size becomes larger and larger and larger. Right? It's the limit to which x bar will go as the sample size becomes larger and larger and larger, right? That is called the mathematical expectation of x. What is the difference between x bar and expectation x? X bar is nothing but each value of the random variable multiplied by its relative frequency and sum. Whereas the mathematical expectation is each value of the random variable multiplied by its probability and sum. Right, and the idea is as the sample size becomes large, relative frequencies get closer and closer to probabilities. So the mathematical, so the arithmetic mean x bar gets closer and closer to the mathematical expectation because the only difference between the two goes away. Is this idea absolutely clear now? Right, and that's why arithmetic means are very important to us. As economists, you'll realize, as statisticians will realize, all the quantities, see ultimately, you see, so as the sample size becomes infinitely large, what do I get closer and closer to the population value, no? So for example, if I am taking, including more and more and more Mumbaikers in my sample, if my sample becomes infinitely large, I will get closer and closer to the population value. So it says as the sample size becomes larger and larger and larger, the arithmetic mean you will get will be increasingly closer and closer and closer to the population value that you have, right? Okay, and that's why arithmetic means are very important. Because arithmetic means based on samples
will have this property that they get closer and closer to the population. This is a very important idea in economics called the law of large numbers. Okay, this idea that we just talked to you about is called the law of large numbers and is a very, very critical idea, a kind of a cornerstone on the, you know, on which we base our econometrics. Right? So law of large numbers. It says as the sample size becomes larger and larger and larger, the sample mean will get closer and closer and closer to the population. Okay, in other words, we also say that the sample mean is a consistent estimator of the population mean, which by which statistician means that as the sample size gets larger and larger and larger, the arithmetic mean gets closer and closer and closer to the population mean, which is another way of stating the law of large numbers. Which is another way of stating the law of large numbers. Is this clear to everybody? Sure? Right? Okay? Now in college, so everybody was familiar with the arithmetic mean, right? Now actually, nearly all the quantities that we have learnt in class are kind of quantities which are based on arithmetic means. For example, some of you who learned this discipline called, you know, descriptive statistics, learned that there is something called measures of central tendency and there are measures of dispersion, right?
Yes.
And they are two different things. They are not two different things. Right? They are very much the same. Because how to calculate the variance of x? Now you have done that in your bridge course. I'm not going to talk to you about how to sort of generalize those ideas and all that. Right? But, or say let me, I'm a bit tempted for this. Yes? So let me ask you a very, very simple question. Let me ask you a very simple question, which I ask every year, okay? So there is a road like this. Yeah, there is a plain, flat road, straight direction. This is where the road begins. So you say that's where the marker called zero is there. Right? For example, Mumbai, the 0 point Mumbai is at the GPO, you know, the little post office. There actually also a book called 0 point Mumbai. So that's where the city starts, right? That's from where you start measuring distances. Sure? Then, there's 1 kilometer, there's 2 kilometers. And suppose you live exactly opposite that 1 kilometer. So your distance from zero is exactly 1 kilometer. And suppose your friend lives exactly at the stone called 2 kilometers. Right? Okay? Now, I'll ask you a question. What is the distance of your friend's house from your house?
1 kilometer.
1 kilometer? Everybody says 1 kilometer. Why? Distance of your friend's house from your house is, according to all of you, 1 kilometer. Why? So this is 2 minus 1. So the milestone in front of your friend's house is 2. Milestone in front of your house is 1. So 2 minus 1. Right. So can we arrive at this general rule? To find out the distance from point F to point Y, we should take the milestone in front of point F and subtract from it the milestone in front of point 1. Is that a good answer? Is it a good answer? Is that a good answer or bad? Good or bad? So by the same logic, if I have to find the distance from point Y to point F here, what do I have to do? So if you find the point distance from point F to point Y, you do the milestone in front of point F and subtract it from it the milestone of point Y. So if I have to find the distance from point Y to point F, what will I do here then by the same logic? I should take the number on the milestone in front of Y and subtract from it the milestone in front of F. What will I then get?
Minus 1.
Minus 1. But can distances be negative?
No.
And can the distance from F to Y be different from the distance from Y to F on a straight line?
No.
So there is something wrong with your answer. Right? There is something wrong with your answer. Right? Okay. There are two ways of resolving this. One is the natural way of saying that you obviously take this, do Y minus F, but because distances cannot be negative, neglect the sign and take only the absolute value. Right? So one way of finding the distance is to say and put an absolute value. Things would be hunky-dory, fine, nice, right? Other way of doing about this is to say take y minus f square. Right? Take y minus f square. Then the answer is you will get the same answers both. For some reasons, which we will only learn toward the end of this semester, statisticians have used this method rather than this method for many, many years. It's only increasingly now, with the advent of desktop computers and fast computing, that they have started to use this as a way of measuring distances. Right? Otherwise, for the last 300 odd years, statisticians have been essentially using this method to conceptualize distances. Right, for some good statistical reasons, which we will come to when we come to this point. Now you see, this is a workable thing, but it has a problem. One problem is, suppose your friend lives here, T. Right? So what is the difference from Y to T according to this formula?
4.
So I have to do 3 minus 1 square. So this distance is 4, right? But what is this distance? 1. 2 minus 1 square. What is this distance?
1.
So what is this distance plus this distance?
2.
But this distance is nothing but this distance plus this distance, no?
Yes.
So we have a problem in measuring these distances. So what we do is square root. Right? We put a square root. Okay. Now let's use these ideas to sort of underuse something that we know. So there is a road again, a flat road. There is a banyan tree in the middle of the road. Okay. So this is, so there's 0 for this. 1, 2, 3. Okay? And suppose one fine afternoon, 3 friends come here. Okay? And sit down under the banyan tree. One of the friends walks up to this point. Okay? Another friend walks up to this point. And this friend says, I'll not go anywhere, I'll go to sleep under this tree. Okay? So this third friend doesn't go anywhere, just goes to sleep under the shade of the nice banyan tree. Now in the evening they decide to find out what is the total distance covered by all these three friends. Using this formula, this square, right? So what is the distance covered by the first person?
1.
So that is, you get 1 minus 2 square. The distance covered by the second person is 2 minus 2 square, right? Plus the distance covered by the third person is 3 minus 2 square. That's how we decided to measure the distances. Okay? Right. Now, instead of this, I call this x1. Instead of this, I call this x2, x3. And suppose this number I call x2. Then this whole thing can be written as right? Sure, x3 minus x2 square. Sure? You also will realize that x2 is nothing but